it's snowing on Titan. No, snow isn't the right word. It's methane clathrate, a hydrocarbon compound that precipitates in the lower atmosphere when the wind blows cold over Kraken Mare. Earthly sailors underestimate Titan's methane seas. They look up at the milky sky and see only stillness. It comforts them, and ahead of the bow they see waves measured in centimeters that never break. Waves that slide away into the oily darkness of a world shrouded in orange haze. All worlds seem calm from Earth's perspective. There's anger in Earth's oceans, a deep, constant fury. The violence of our home world tempers our perception of danger here on Titan. But methane seas deceive. On Earth, I sailed an old-style sailboat with a wooden hull. It was fast and graceful, its keel long and aggressive. It was heavy and narrow, but you're on Titan, a boat like that wouldn't stay afloat on the methane sea. It would sink like a stone. Methane seas don't forgive. You can't swim in liquid methane. You can't float in liquid methane. But now I'm here, at the helm of a vessel crafted for the winds and seas of this wild world. Like a magnolia blossom gliding lightly over small waves, its hull barely touching the surface. I love the winds that blow with clathrate snow. I love the cold on my face. I love the chill on my skin. I love the way the sail sings as it glides across an alien sea. I love the way it stings my tongue and burns my lungs. I left Earth to sail alone among the stars. I'm no longer human, but I have no regrets. I'm a sailor on the seas of Titan. Just think about it. In the entire solar system, there's only one other place besides Earth that boasts seas and lakes. Not the ones on our moon merely bearing names of lakes and seas. True liquid expanses embraced by coasts and shores swept by winds and bathed in gentle waves. And we're not talking about simple circular craters filled with liquid, but seas surrounded by rugged coasts, articulating into winding peninsulas and bold headlands with large islands scattered in between. Large seas entirely navigable. Sure, these seas are made of liquid methane, not water. But what difference does it make for those who simply want to sail on them? But hold on, let's go in order. Titan has a methane cycle similar to Earth's, where methane clouds produce rain and even storms on the moon's surface. The Cassini-Huygens mission allowed us to take a closer look at this planet and its chemistry, detecting the presence of a surface haze made up of nitrogenous organic compounds and seas of liquid hydrocarbons. Data also suggested the possible presence of cryovolcanoes erupting cold liquid methane or ammonia. The upper atmosphere of Titan is rich in nitrogen and methane molecules. When exposed to lighter cosmic rays, these molecules break, triggering a cascade of chemical reactions, leading to the formation of hydrocarbons and other organic molecules. So far, only two space missions have visited Titan. Voyager 1 flew by on November 12, 1980, passing within 7,000 kilometers of its surface at a relative speed of 17.3 kilometers per second. Scholars believe that such a close passage would allow them to glimpse details of the surface between the clouds, but the lower portion of the atmosphere proved completely impenetrable. Titan appeared as a ball wrapped in a yellowish mist, preventing any observations. The second mission took place many years later when the Cassini spacecraft orbited Saturn from 2004 to 2017, exploring the entire system. Cassini, approaching Titan every few weeks, used onboard radar to pierce through the haze, revealing the presence of hundreds of lakes of various sizes gathered around the North Pole. In contrast, the equatorial regions visited in 2005 by the Huygens probe, which landed on the bed of a dry river, turned out to be sandy and desolate. Titan was already known as an extremely exotic place with a dense atmosphere rich in organic substances, but the seas and hundreds of lakes discovered by Cassini gave us an absolutely unique world in the desolate, and let's admit it, desolating panorama of our solar system. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. After the amazement, the largest sea covering 400,000 square kilometers, like our Caspian Sea, was named Kraken, while the second largest spanning 126,000 square kilometers was called Lygia, all names of earthly sea monsters. Meanwhile, the lakes were given names of terrestrial lakes. This discovery, however, changed everything. We've already mentioned that the average temperature on Titan is so low, minus 180 degrees Celsius, that methane liquefies and undergoes a cycle similar to water on Earth, evaporating and forming clouds that then fall into rivers and lakes. Well, this combination of air and liquid means that Titan could be explored using vehicles capable of hovering, navigating above or even beneath the surface. This is why proposals for Titan exploration rely on a variety of solutions, from a drone capable of circumnavigating the globe for surface mapping to an aerostatic balloon drifting with the winds, and even a sailboat or a submarine. According to the plan, the balloon mission would carry instruments to measure temperature, pressure, composition, and wind in the air, exploring various regions of Titan for at least 6 months, and occasionally landing to collect soil samples. The drone mission would have a camera, radar, spectrometer, and magnetic field sensor on board, exploring different areas of interest for at least 3 months. The proposed boat would be able to land on one of Titan's seas and navigate its surface, equipped with a camera, radar, spectrometer, and weather sensor to study composition, waves, tides, and currents. As for the submarine, about 6 meters long, its itinerary has already been planned. The journey would begin in the center of Kraken Mare, then ascend to Mare Sinis, where the submarine would spend 3 weeks measuring tides and composition before crossing the Bada Fredum Strait and heading south through a gorge-like passage called Selden Fredum. During these explorations, it would map the seabed and capture detailed images of the coast. In total, over 90 days, the small submarine could travel more than 3,000 kilometers at a speed of 1 kilometer per hour. Unfortunately, most of these mission projects were not pursued, mainly due to lack of funding. In the end, Dragonfly, a rotary-wing aircraft capable of flying tens of kilometers at a time, was chosen for the mission. The Dragonfly mission, scheduled for launch in 2026, will include an impressive array of tools for remote planetary exploration. Cameras operating at various wavelengths, a small drill and a scoop for collecting samples, 2 spectrometers and a suite of sensors to search for evidence of large-scale geological activity, such as the presence of cryovolcanoes. This suite of equipment will provide us with our first real taste of what Titan is truly like, and whether it might conceal important secrets of the solar system, such as the possibility of life existing even in those extreme conditions. It is precisely this potential for life that makes Titan such a compelling target for exploration. The carbon-based chemicals present in the atmosphere and soil, such as methane, ethane, propane, and octane, are believed to be similar to those found on Earth in its primordial days before life emerged. One scientist has described Titan as the frozen primitive Earth. Did primitive life evolve on Titan, or will it in the future when the Sun transforms into a red giant and the outer solar system warms up? The possibility that life may have emerged there, or that a kind of primordial broth exists on Titan, means that we must be extremely careful with any spacecraft we send there. It is necessary to ensure that the vehicles are thoroughly sterilized before leaving Earth to avoid contaminating the environment, or worse, creating a War of the Worlds scenario, where Earth organisms wipe out those of Titan. Saturn has another moon, Enceladus, believed to have a salty ocean beneath its icy surface that could also harbor life. Cross-contamination between worlds is a serious issue as we explore the solar system. But returning to the Dragonfly mission, set to arrive in 2034, one might wonder, did NASA make the best choice? We hope so, but we believe that a maritime approach would have been much bolder and more interesting, something never attempted on another world, apart from our own, of course. Clearly, the boat would have been nothing more than a capsule, nothing resembling a real boat. It would have been just afloat with little or no maneuverability, drifting with the weak winds of Kraken Mare once it landed. But we'd like to think that someday we can achieve something much more adventurous and romantic, in line with the prologue of this beautiful video. We want to imagine that in the future, someone will get it into their head to sail the Kraken Mare with a real sailboat, as similar as possible to those that solo sailors here on Earth challenge the worst storms with. It would be a dream, of course, but what kind of dream? A scientific dream or just a fantasy with no chance of realization? First of all, what kind of boat would we need? Let's try to reason about it. The density of liquid methane is about 0.42 grams per cubic centimeter, less than half of that of water. This means that the sailboat should have a shape that allows it to float without sinking too much. For example, it could have a flat and wide hull or air chambers that increase its volume and decrease its density. This type of sailboat is called a catamaran, and it consists of two hulls connected by a structure. The catamaran has the advantage of greater stability and less water resistance compared to a single-hull boat. Although the seas and lakes of Titan have only 42% of the density of water, they also have only 8% of the viscosity. This means that a sailboat on Titan would experience only about 26% of the frictional resistance compared to its Earth equivalent. This allows us to make the hull deeper, important for compensating for density, and longer if we want a longer waterline, which would improve speed. The sail itself would receive on average less wind on Titan than on Earth. According to Cassini, the average wind speed on Titan seems to be about 3 meters per second, although it might be higher over the lakes. The average wind speed over Earth's oceans is closer to 6.6 meters per second. However, Titan's atmosphere is also 4 times denser than Earth's, and both lift and drag are proportional to the fluid density. All in all, this means that the total force of the wind on the sail will be about 83% of what you would get on Earth, all other factors being equal, which could be sufficient. Of course, the hull will need to be completely isolated from the external environment, which presupposes careful selection of materials and the ability to control the boat from the inside. All in all, nothing is impossible to achieve. Certainly, sailing on Kraken Mare will have a very different feel from what sailing in the Gulf of Mexico might offer. No outings on deck, no opportunity to control the boat from the outside, no sun on the skin. It's true that Titan's atmospheric pressure, slightly higher than Earth's, would allow us to survive even without a pressurized suit. Wearing only an oxygen mask and an insulated suit would be enough. But it wouldn't be a romantic and relaxed navigation, of course. Unless the one navigating the boat and being the solo sailor on Titan is a modified human. You've got it. I'm talking about cyborg, the form that the human being will take in its process of evolution through integration and technology. Some say that by 2150, we might be able to expand the human genome to make it resistant to extreme environments. That would be nice. And perhaps it will be one of them who lead the first sailboat from one shore to the other of Kraken Mare, from one sunset to another. The first sailor on the seas of Titan.